Is anybody watching? If so, in this video, you will hear about an entirely new model for spiritual help, as well as a explanation of how you can truly liberate yourself from actual age, infirmity, and ultimately death. There is a new model of understanding for that. Both of these came today. Start with the second one first. If we take it that this experience we're having is an attempt to recollect what it was like to trying to remember an experience we think we had, which was experience of being greater than God. Existence is the way that we pretend to be remembering this state that we were in, this state that's separate from spaciousness, separate from God, greater than God. Now, the way that we symbolize it is very interesting. The way we try to remember it is very interesting. Take it that our birth, our youth, middle age, and then old age and death is actually the way that we are trying to remember what this experience was like. Take it that like our birth was, and then we grow up young, full of energy and life and vigor and all that, symbolizes reality, symbolizes it. And then we start getting older. What happens when you get older is you try to remember what it was like when you were younger. Okay, that's what I found, is when I was limber and full of energy, I'm trying to think, what? Gradually, you've been to forget this, how it felt. Gradually, you get older and older and older, and finally death would symbolize complete forgetfulness of what it was like to, quote-unquote, feel alive. When you look at it this way, it's like bingo. The whole thing comes into focus. You say, oh my gosh, it's all a dream. It's all a dream. All of this is just a dream. Existence is just a dream, and it symbolizes a process of losing touch with, losing sight of reality, as it were. In other words, we go through, and so the remembrance of being greater than reality is being symbolized by a process of forgetting about reality, progressively forgetting about reality. Now, you may have these experiences of sudden Satori type of experiences, like you say, I remember reality. And what happens after that? You forget it, right? You forget it. And you go through these progressive forgetting until it's just a distant, vague notion. And you say, did I ever really have that experience? This is all done intentionally to symbolize a process of separating from reality. So we feel that we have invented this idea that we've already been separate from reality, and we've established a new identity based on the separation, but we've forgotten it, and we're trying to remember, you know, what it was like. And so we're trying to remember, how do we get there? How do we do this? Well, the secret is, of course, we never did it. But we in this dream, we're thinking that we did it, and we've forgotten it. And so we're thinking, how did we get there? And I say, we got there by gradually forgetting about reality, sort of like we're moving away from it. It's like in our rearview mirror, and gradually it recedes and recedes and recedes and recedes and recedes until death means that reality's gone completely. If you use this as a model for our situation, then the whole dream nature of existence suddenly comes into perspective very strongly. I saw it today. I just said, oh my gosh. It's just none of this is necessary at all. We don't have to age at all. We don't have to die at all. We don't have to feel tired at all. None of that. That is all part of the dream of forgetting what reality was like, as if a journey away from life to this other state. And we think that by doing this, we're going to arrive at that other state, which is greater than God. This is as if existence is helping us remember, get back to that state. But the truth is, there never was such a state. Never was such a state, which makes this all so completely absurd. Such a complete farce. Now, the first part I mentioned in the video was an entirely new model of spiritual help. This came today, just incredible stuff. I'm going to use a model that we can relate to in modern times, the sports agent, okay? Now, I have familiarity with this field, following sports. And what happens is there are prospects, the way it really plays out is there are prospects who show a great deal of potential. And there are agents whose job it is to find the talent, the future talent, okay, as well as the present talent. And the agent makes contact with the prospect, and the prospects are young and often naive, and we have this corporation like Major League Baseball that's very smart and slick, and these contracts are very sophisticated, and there's a lot of money involved. There's personal appearances, there's endorsements, there's a massive amount of pressure on these superstars, both of today and tomorrow. The agent comes to, like, for instance, a young superstar, and they say, you know what, I think you're going to become very, very marketable in baseball. You're going to command a huge contract, and you're going to be part of the Major League brand. And I believe I'm telling you that representation would be very, very helpful to you. So an agent, let's say it's a very, very good agent who says, look, if you don't have very good representation, you're going to get taken advantage of severely. Okay, so you have the right. You have the right to have representation by someone who knows how the whole business works, okay? So that on your behalf, I will act on your behalf as your agent, making sure that, you know, you get treated fairly, you get proper compensation based on what the pay scales are, that your personal appearances are handled properly, your publicity, and on and on and on and on. There's a vast, vast amount of stuff that the agent actually has to look out for on behalf of the athlete. Now, consider that we as spiritual aspirants are like athletes, okay? The gurus are agents, okay? They're like agents, business agents, spiritual business agents is the way to look at it. And they are aware of the up-and-coming talent, just like a sports agent will be aware of the people, of the players in the high school, college, minor leagues, etc. They know who the up-and-coming people are. They're very aware of this. And then as they come into the major leagues, the ones that start to excel, you know, clients, the agents will say, hey, you know, this is what our agency has to offer you. And the players will take a look at it and say, you know, yeah, I think I want to sign up with your agency. I want you to be my agent representing me in all these complicated legal situations and very involved stuff. And to run interference from all the, you know, people who try to take advantage of you. So many angles of people who try to take advantage of these superstar athletes, actually. So the agent is an extremely valuable person. Most agents are pretty good. They do a pretty good job. They're professionals, and some are like really, really good. They do an incredible job. And just let the athlete do what they want, you know, do best, okay? The agent takes care of the rest. And it's an amazing situation. Now, using this as a model, we will say that the new model for gurus are as this spiritual business agent, actually. The guru recognizes somebody who's an up-and-coming, who's going to be, who has a very good work ethic and developing very great deal of clarity. They come and make contact with them and say, hey, I'd like to represent you. You know, it would be an honor. I'd really like to represent you, and I think I could help you out a lot. And then you consider that and say, you know, consider the agent and see if you want to have a contract with them. So this is a new model, actually. And working through this today, I found it's a fabulous, incredible model. And it just resonates so strongly. Just way better way for me to look at things, actually. What I want to do is I want an agent, I want you to take care of all interaction I have with planet Earth, okay? You're in charge of all that. Nobody gets to me without going through you first. So the agent is like a filter, the spiritual business agent is like a filter that has an office, so to speak, and nobody can talk to you or do anything with you, but no projects whatsoever without first being vetted by the spiritual business agent, okay? They have to go through the guru first, everything. And I realized, hey, that's a great arrangement, actually, super great arrangement. So all these people pitching projects at you, you know, pitching this, pitching that, pitching that, they have to go through the agent. The agent vets everyone. Personal relationships, they vet. All projects, they vet. Every aspect of life, they vet. Anyone who wants to have any interaction with you whatsoever, they vet them clearly. Now, the great thing is that the guru, as the spiritual business agent, the perfect guru, knows exactly what is good for you in your development. And so it will filter everything according to this perfect knowledge. And so those things that are right for you, the guru will say, okay, here, you know, and talk to you and say, I recommend this project or this situation, whatever. And you say, and then you can say, okay, I accept your judgment on this because I know that you have my best interest at heart, the best interest of truth at heart, so you're making perfectly accurate, you know, assessments. Whereas the fact is that we can't make these perfect assessments at this point. You know, we're in the world so much, we're struggling, we're getting hit by so many different stuff, so much stuff. We need help. We need an agent. We really need an agent. So if like you were a superstar, young superstar athlete, you'd say, you know what, I really need an agent because I've got people coming at me constantly from every angle. But now you just say, oh, wait a minute. Okay, I'm putting an office out front of my house or my whatever, and everybody has to go through that office if they want to talk with me at all, even talk with me, do anything. No exceptions. Everybody. And the ones that are legit, and it's a beneficial thing, the agent will be able to recognize that and say, okay. So it's a protective device, it's a filtering device, it's an extremely helpful thing. And I believe this is what the real purpose of gurus are. This is how it's been revealed to me today. It's a pragmatic thing, entirely pragmatic thing. It's almost like a business type of model where what happens is you get freed from all the leeches and the parasites and the hangers-on and those who wish you evil and those who want to drag you down and those who want to waste your time and those who want to confuse you and on and on and on and on and on, and on all this stuff. There are just a massive amount of stuff. The guru deals with them. You don't have to deal with them anymore. That is called like the guru taking your karma off your shoulders, really. Because not only does it deal with stuff on this dimension, but all dimensions, all subtle, quote-unquote, levels, from all the parasites and all the negative stuff, all the positive, everything. Now, so if you retain a spiritual sports agent, spiritual business agent, a true guru who asks to be your agent, then everyone goes through that agent, without exception. Jesus would have to go through the agent. Buddha would have to go through that. Ananda Maimon would have to go through that. Everyone. No exceptions. That's how I feel. That's my, what I want. And I tell the agent, drop a contract and I'll sign it. You know, you have carte blanche. Carte blanche on all decisions in my life. Carte blanche. You every single thing, you have the right to look at it. Okay? So it's a perfect filter, actually. It's a protective sort of thing. And it helps you go faster on the spiritual path because you're not being dragged down so badly in many ways. So, this is an incredible new model. And to me, it's just crystal clear, like this is exactly what I want, exactly what I need. And what people really need is they need an agent, a spiritual business agent, to assist them. Okay, so everybody has to get cleared by this, your agent first. The gatekeeper, the agent is the gatekeeper to your life, literally the gatekeeper. And if people are legit and it's all good and they can come and explain it, and the gatekeeper will say, you know what, this is a very good situation, you can now talk to him and we'll help together, we'll all, you know, make something work properly. But if you're shady, if you're trying to, you know, the agent will say no, we're not interested in this. So you give the agent the right to make decisions on your behalf is what it is. So essentially, you need a perfect guru. I mean, you need someone you really trust. You have to trust your agent. That's a fact. And Are there such agents? Yes, I believe there are. I believe there are some super, really super great spiritual business agents who you can really trust and let them make these all these decisions as to are these people really, you know, helping you? Are they really trying to pull you down? That kind of stuff. Yeah, no exceptions. No, nobody gets around this. You don't make any side deals, secret deals that the agent isn't aware of. No. The agent is able to be aware of the totality of your existence and every facet of it, and then make decisions on each and every facet of it like that. Now, how can you possibly agree to such a thing? Only if you realize the completely illusory nature of existence, that this ludicrous, and it's all completely whimsical notion of trying to recollect the times when we were greater than God, or that state, as if we sort of fallen out of that state. The whole idea of a fall out of a state is a complete lie, because we were never in that state. We were never in that state. So karma again is a lie too. It's all a lie. It's all a deception entirely. So you don't have to grow. You don't have to go through all this stuff at levels. There are no real levels at all. You simply have to accept the truth of what is, the truth of the whole situation. And so the perfect teacher, the guru, knows this. They know, and they're not fooled. You can't fool them. So all we have to get to is this knowing. That's it. That's all we have to get to. So it has nothing to do with learning to make decisions on our own, or maturing or anything like that. No, it is simply getting the pressure off of us, so we're not pulled down so badly, so we're able to see this and get steady in it and accept it. And then once we know, then we too can be agents, actually, spiritual business agents for others. So there is this chain of agents that give rise to more agents that are be able to help more people. So these super agents, these super gurus, are looking for those they want to represent. They're aware of the ones that are working hard. Okay, I've always been told this, just keep working really, really hard and it won't go unnoticed, you know. So maybe an agent approached me, I believe that happened. An agent approached me and I've said yes. I said absolutely yes. I trust this agent. And I said, carte blanche, okay. There's no secret side deals, you know. I'm not making any of that. Full access, 24/7 full access. And what your recommendations, we're going to go with those. And I said, draw up a contract. I don't have to read it. I'll just sign it. It's good. I trust you. Contract, like that type of thing. Or just, a handshake. It's just a handshake. Just to say, okay, we're going to do it. So this kind of brings out of the shadows of mysticism, mystique, the whole kind of guru relationship sort of thing. It's a pragmatic, practical thing. They're like an agent. Very much like an agent, actually. And we are very much like the vulnerable superstars who get undermined in so much press, you know, and it's so many people, hangers-on, and people trying to exploit them, and people trying to inflate them too much or deflate them, and it's a nightmare. Agents are run interference for all that kind of stuff, all of it. So that's what we really need in this time. We really need those agents, and so you can be protected. It's called taking refuge in the agent, actually. You know, they say take refuge in the Buddha. Well, what's the Buddha? A super agent, right? A super spiritual business agent. Super filter, that which is able to filter out everything that is harmful, pulls you down. And we don't need to do it ourselves. See, that's the whole thing. The ego tricks us into thinking we need to do it ourselves. What it really means is the ego saying you need to remember how you forgot reality by failing. By failing, really. Existence is born to fail. It's an intentional failing based on the notion that this is how we recall getting free of reality, all right? And again, the so-called fall from grace, fall from heaven, is really where what we're really saying is that we were in this state greater than heaven, but somehow we fell from it, you know? something like that. Or you can call that as it as we fell from reality, you know, forgetting, more and more forgetting. And that forgetfulness of reality is actually supposedly the remembrance of how we got to some separate state, which we never got to. Never existed. We've never been there. So putting things in the new context, you'll find that everything just says, my gosh, it's so easy. It's way better to put it in new context than the struggle within the old context. Way, way, way better. That's what I'm all about. I'm to get free of the boxes, even the spiritual boxes, religious boxes that box us in, you know, this way and that way. Get free of that way of thinking, because it holds us back severely, actually. So I believe that an agent approached me. I have that feeling that happened. A really super agent. And, you know, why do I believe that? Because I know I put in the work, and I know I'm able to think outside the box actually extremely well. Just from enormous effort and practice, and just intensely trying to do so, actually. I never tried to memorize religious stuff or spiritual stuff or anything. I've always tried to find something that seemed to show a new light, a simpler, more complete, total light upon it all. And so I'm able to come up with this and do this. So I'm not surprised that someone might say, hey, I'd like to, you know, represent you. And it's done out of compassion, because they want to help the world. They want to help all of us. And if they see somebody who's very promising, they're going to say, hey, I want to make sure that one blossoms, because they're going to help others, a lot of people as well. So, I'm not surprised at all. Yeah, I'm thrilled. I'm delighted to have an agent. And we'll see how that goes. I don't know how it's going to go. But to me, this model makes absolute sense. And you can think about that too. Because maybe someday for sure, you'll be contacted by an agent, and they'll say, I'd like to represent you. You know, then you can say, hey, yeah, okay, I'm familiar with that whole notion of that. So we need to bring the gurus out of the cold, you know, out of the darkness, out of the shadows of mysticism, all that stuff. Bring them into the modern world here. Let them breathe here, okay? And let us see it now. This is my agent, you know. You don't even have to call guru. This is my spiritual agent, my spiritual business agent. All dealings go through this agent. You know, if you want any dealings with me, first you have to clear it with my spiritual agent. Period. No exceptions. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're Jesus. You still have to go through it. Unless Jesus is your spiritual agent. Okay, then that obviously then everyone would have to go through Jesus. A lot of people choose Jesus. I don't know. Actually, the agent chooses you. Okay, the agent chooses you. The agent comes to you and says, I would like to represent you. Can you please consider this? And then you give it consideration. So, you just can't go to Jesus. Hey, Jesus, you're my agent. I mean, I believe that Jesus has to make the approach and say, I'd like to represent you. Because I want you, you know, I know you're some valuable asset. You're a valuable asset. Same thing with every teacher. Every teacher, the agent makes the approach, in my opinion. That's how I see it. So when we're fortunate enough for an agent to make an approach, you know, that's a very fortunate thing, actually. I mean, the agent sees the potential in you, a lot of potential, and wants to help you and says, look, I'll run interference for you. I'll make sure you don't get taken advantage of. I'll make sure that, you know, the way is made easy for you. That's the whole purpose of the guru system, the agent system. Make the way easier. Make it quicker and easier. Period. That's it. Quicker and easier. So when I saw this new model of existence, I said, oh my gosh, it's just based on this idea of forgetting reality. And that this, when we're young, that symbolizes reality, and we get gradually older, and our memory of what it was like to be young gets fades away. That's all intentional. It's all intentional. And it's all just a dream. It's all just an attempt to remember what never happened. And so it's completely unnecessary. And I just saw that we can be liberated from age entirely. Liberated from fatigue, liberated from forgetfulness. This whole idea of having an experience and then forgetting it, that is all a model of this attempt to recall how we left reality, and we never did leave reality. So we don't need that model, actually. And I just saw the totality of this crystal clear like that. And I said, you know, yeah, I can see how an agent, a spiritual agent, would definitely want to approach somebody that's capable of doing that. There's no question about it. Because it's a rarity, you know. You just don't come and read this kind of stuff. But I literally saw it. So yeah, I mean that's. It's not a surprise. I'm not surprised. Happy about it, and I don't know how it's going to play out. I really don't. But I'm working on it every day to kind of examine the parameters of the situation, and it's a guru-disciple relationship, but put into the modern context, and I think a better context in a lot of ways. It's direct seeing. Where I'm at is no methodology at all, because there's none needed. It's just to see the totality of the situation. Just as it is, and the ability to accept it. This is all, this whole being born and then aging and then dying thing is all just a fantasy that we've invented that supposedly represents how we escape from reality. And then the idea is, by going through this, we'll remember then what it was like to dwell in a higher state, you know? And it's all just complete farce. And seeing it that way, it just revolutionizes. I feel revolutionized almost in my approach. I don't even know what my approach is. It's just like completely direct. So I think that's auspicious. And I've been hopefully, I've always wanted to have a spiritual agent. And I've never quite felt the fullness of that, and never really feel that I have entirely, really. Something that someone that really, really resonates with the way I'm looking at it. You know, really, you know, you need an agent that resonates with you. That you feel that they're going to help you mature in the direction that you're maturing in. And how? By the fact that they've already done it. They've already done it. Now, Jesus, for instance, is great for the those who take the approach of love and relationships of people and love and things like that. And there's many people who resonate with that. I don't happen to resonate that way. I resonate with seeing the totality as it is right now, the immediacy of the situation, right this instant, the whole picture, the whole farce, as it were, of this dream. That's simply the way that I do it. So my agent is an expert at that. That's the way my agent approaches it. And so I say, okay, I see the maturity there. For instance, let's say you're like a virtuoso piano player, and you can tell in like a moment or two, if someone sits down to play a piano, you can tell where they're at easily. It doesn't take it, because you know where all the difficulty lies in the totality of the piano. Where's all the difficulty? Where's all the, you know, there's so many facets to it, and you've mastered them all, basically, or almost all. So you can tell where someone's at. It's easy. Now, what if someone who sits down, they play, and they do everything flawlessly, effortlessly, and laugh as a piece of cake, and you know right away that they're, you know, total masters. You know right away. Because you yourself are really good, but they're way better. And you know they are, because you know what's difficult, and you know they do it easily. So it's not difficult to recognize someone who's very spiritual master. It's not difficult at all. Just take a couple seconds, I just recognize, say, whoa, you know, that's like super, super difficult, and they breeze through it like it's nothing. So, yeah. It's like, okay, you're way better than I am. I mean, I understand, you know, but yeah, I can learn something from it. You can really teach me something. There's no question about it. So it's not difficult. Nana my ma was someone very different that some resonate with her, and she, the way that she taught was it's hard to explain. But even there, I don't quite resonate with it. Because again, I resonate with this very clear explanation. What I like to do is give extremely clear, big picture explanations that, you know, turn everything inside out, outside the box, and bring everything into this new focus like that. That's what I can do. So that's how I go at it. And that was not really her way so much. So I don't quite resonate with either Jesus or Ananda my mom, even though I recognize they're virtuosos, you know, they're great spiritual masters. It's not my lineage. It's not my lineage. It really isn't. So the agent that approached me and said he'd like to represent me is Longchenpa. And I'd never even heard of this teacher at all. But instantly I recognized, whoa. Yeah, this plays exactly my kind of music, and does it flawlessly. It's unbelievably well. I just said, holy cow. Just took me just a brief moment. I just immediately recognized that this one is just off the charts. And so this one, I can see, has the maturity that I want to have. I want to be like that, actually. That's how I want to be like. So it makes sense. It makes sense to me. Someone who's just effortlessly able to bring you, you know, into this complete acceptance of the immediacy of truth. You know, just a complete acceptance of the immediacy of truth. That's a jewel, you know, that's a real jewel for me. And I don't do any of the tantras or any of the practices, the mantra, I don't do any of that stuff. And if, for some reason, you know, Longchenpa strikes me as somebody who's actually above all that stuff. I mean, he's able to help people that way, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But fundamentally, none of that stuff, you know, he says basically drop it all. You don't need it. You don't need it at all. You know, you never needed it. It's this higher kind of teaching. It's the apex yoga teaching that he's so superb at, actually. Now, the tradition that came down from him, the whatever you call it, Nying something teaching, doesn't matter for me, for my purpose, what do you call it, but he's got all, you know, these techniques, tantra mean techniques, all sorts of techniques, so many things, thousands of practicing all these various techniques, but from what I see, he's not really into that at all. Just completely above that, saying, look, you know, all that stuff has its place. Everything has its place. But this is all a dream. It's all a dream. You recognize the nature of that directly. Abide in it directly. The immediacy of truth. Absolute immediacy of truth. Inescapable immediacy of truth. And just, you know, accepting that. That is where I'm at right now. That's where I'm at. So, that's a very good agent for me. Now, for others, it wouldn't be the appropriate agent. You know, really. There's some, they want the devotion. You know, they want the path of love and relationships. They want the path of tantras of all types of, you know, saying the mantra and the mudra and all these various practices. They want all these practices. And some want the intellectual kind of the slicing and dicing thing, which, you know, they want. But really, what I'm talking about, the apex yoga, is not intellectual at all. It's like completely blowing the doors off the intellect, actually. It's just saying you don't need any intellect, because the truth, the immediacy of the truth is right here, right now. We're in it. We never left it. This whole thing was a complete farce. It's all a clever twist of we're just remembering, you know, the higher reality that we somehow fell out of. This whole falling out of thing is the biggest lie ever. That implies there's something to fall out of, right? So we take this whole existence, this involutionary, evolutionary thing, or involution, falling away. We fell from grace, we fell out of, no, we didn't fall out of anything. How can you fall out of pure spaciousness? How can you fall out of it? You cannot. We never fell. We've never fallen. There's been no falling whatsoever. And so that's what I mean about the immediacy of truth. We're not falling. We're not falling through space. Okay, nothing is falling. It's never been falling. And that this is like a direct realization, right? It goes beyond the intuition, the intellect, all of that. And I want an agent like that. That's their specialty. That's their specialty. So I don't want to jump the gun on this, but I am sharing this. It's cold out here. Woo, outside, and it's starting to really get cold. It's going to be real heavy fog drizzle this morning, and the next morning for a couple days now. Just because we're in this crisis time, and we really need a new model, we need to get clear on all this. And if we can pick up on this, you know, I picked it up like that in a day. I just said, hey, this makes sense. This all fits. So literally, I think in a day's time, you can make so much progress. You can literally entertain a whole new paradigm for spiritual help. A whole new paradigm. Everybody deserves an agent, spiritual agent. Everybody deserves one, believe me. And if you're trying to operate without one, no, that's a bad thing. Bad thing. And just accept, like for me, the thing is, it's like Jesus is such an incredible superstar. If you say, yeah, Jesus is my agent, it's like you're saying to the world, like, wow, I mean, I'm with, you know, the greatest. I must be really great. Or if you say, Ananda, my mom, oh my gosh, geez, you know, she's your spiritual agent. Oh my gosh, you must be something incredible, you know. Or if you say, yeah, my agent's Long Chenpa. Huh? Who? Yeah, who? Well, I've never heard of that. Somehow, I've never heard of him. And most probably haven't. I mean, in the Buddhist tradition, I'm sure that you know, there's some people say, oh, yeah, I've kind of heard of that. But it's kind of a specialty, radical Dzogchen and this apex yoga. And I mean, people, there's no glamour or cachet about that at all. Now, I mean, who's your agent? Longchenpa, huh? Okay, whatever. You know, so, but I'm happy with that. It doesn't bother me. I don't care. What I care is about results. So I want results. I want results. And the other stuff doesn't really matter at all. So this is an important lesson, because I may have delayed my path by thinking, well, I need. If I want to be a really, really good teacher, I need these really great teachers like Jesus or Ananda Maimar or even Ramana Maharshi, you know. But what we really need is results, because that's what works. Remember, the whole thing's pragmatic. If you boil it all down, grace is totally pragmatic. It's aimed at results. So I had to say, I basically said goodbye to Ananda Maimar and gave up trying to get her to be my, you know, spiritual agent, because she's not agreeing to it. Yeah, and I was listening to an interview of someone that was with her for a long time, an American, and during this interview he's talking about, you know, he was in the insider of all this stuff, and I suddenly realized that it didn't have any impact on me whatsoever. Didn't feel anything. And I just realized I'm not part of this. That's not my lineage. That's not my agency. You know, I don't. And it's just, I'll never be able to, you know, be part of that. And it just didn't interest me or anything. And then I realized, you know, it's time to let go of that. Time to let go of that. And move on. I'm finished with that whole thing. And we're here right now. We need results right now. And my mind seems to be very, very capable of accepting the kind of realization that Long Chenpa had. Very capable of that. So why not go with what's going to actually work, you see? That's what's important. So, you know, maybe your spiritual agent is not a big heavyweight or something. I like I said, I had no idea who Long Chenpa was at all. And I really didn't care. It doesn't really matter to me. As long as I get the results, as long as I can trust in them, and I know that they know truth, love truth, they know truth without any flaw, that's all that matters. So, yeah, what their background is historically doesn't matter at all, really. literally doesn't matter. So take that in your own life, you know, when the agent approaches you, just say, hey, will they get me results? Will they give me the results? Will they help me in with that? And, you know, I've spent 36 years something with A Course in Miracles, and it's an amazing thing. It's like I don't have a single friend in the world that's part of A Course in Miracles. I've never been able to connect with anybody with after 36 years of trying. And I look at all the tapes and videos and talks and teachers and A Course in Miracles, and none of it resonates with me. I just feel like I'm not part of it at all. I spent my whole life focused on that, you know, just about incredible effort, and I don't feel I'm even part of that at all, and never will be. So, you know, it's just like, wow, you know, wow, what's going on? Well, it was certainly very helpful for me, super helpful, as was Ananda Maimon, super helpful for me, but they are not my central gurus. Jesus and Ananda Maimon are not my central gurus. This is, apparently this Longchenpa is. Which is fine with me, because again, results are what matters, and I'm seeing results. I'm seeing very clearly that he got results. I know that he absolutely realized the entire situation, so he knows what results are all about. My mind is going in that direction. I'm able to absorb this stuff. You know, the teaching. I can easily can feel the totality. It's just yes, just yes. This is it. No, nothing else needs to be said, really. So this is it, that's it. And that's it. So, that's a pragmatic thing. That's a pragmatic thing. All this glamour and all this other stuff, forget it, it's not pragmatic. But we are after results, because the world right now is just indescribably, there are no words to describe it, actually. There are no words to describe it. It's this frantic froth of, hey, we're just about ready. We've almost remembered how we got separate from reality. We're almost into that state now. We're in that. This intense memory is coming back up. We're remembering, how do we get free of reality? Oh, yeah, this is what we did. Oh, yeah. So we're acting it out like a play. Existence like a play, reminding us of this supposed separation from reality that took place, and that we've somehow fell out of this higher state, and we need to go back and remember it. So we're play acting. How do we do it? How did we do it before? And it's all utter farce, because we never did it in the first place. There's nothing to remember. Nothing to fall from. Nothing to fall from. Where do we stand in pure spaciousness to fall from? Fall out of pure spaciousness. And so we're both simultaneously the actors and the audience in this thing. So we have this world is now acting this incredible play of like, yeah, this is how we got free of reality. And we've almost remembered how we did it. And when we remember how we did it, we will then, we will reestablish ourselves in this new creation, a separate creation from reality. And we'll be prime creators. So the world thinks that it's really close, really close. It's closing in on it. And all this terrible chaos, everything that's going on in the world, that's actually this whole staging of how we supposedly separated from reality. And we're just reminding ourselves, we're just play-acting this as a way to remind ourselves. That's all it is. It's just a play. You know, Shakespeare, in my opinion, was a very great adept, and so, you know, he nailed it, you know, absolutely nailed it in a lot of ways. You know, just a tale full of sound and fury, signifying absolutely nothing. We're all actors strutting upon the stage, you know, doing this tale full of sound and fury, signifying absolutely nothing. That is true. It's all a staging. It's all an act. We're trying to remind ourselves. Like, if we forgot something, and we say, I know I forgot something. How do I remember it? And so we, you know, try to act out various things to try to jog our memory. We're trying to jog our memories, but there is no memory to jog. So it just goes on and on. It's all crazy. It's all crazy what's happening. We don't have any such memory to jog. We don't have any such state to go to. We don't have any second home, some separate home from reality. We don't have some place that's beyond spaciousness, beyond endlessness. We don't have any such place. Never have, never will. It's all complete whimsical desire. Totally. Totally. And we've concocted, the mind has concocted this ridiculous scheme of saying, oh, well, we're, how come we're not there? Oh, we fell out of there. We fell away. We fell out. We fell from grace. That Satan, you know, some Satan came in and corrupted us, and we fell from grace, and now we're living here in this world and all this terrible stuff. How do we fall out of pure spaciousness? Don't tell me that. Now everything is already abiding, always in pure spaciousness. It never fell. There's no falling. Nothing's ever fallen out of it. So we don't need to remember how we fell. We don't need to remember that. We don't need to remember the falling. It's all a fairy tale we've invented. Mind has invented this fairy tale of falling out of this quote-unquote reality. Anything that can be fallen out of is not reality in the first place. So seeing this, it's just like saying, oh, so that's what it is. Okay, that's what it is. It's like that. You say, oh, I see it now. Okay. Wow, all this stuff's totally unnecessary. We're all just making this up. And we all think we're really getting there. Like we almost got it. Almost got it. A lot of people think that when they die, they'll finally get it. You know, having died, that means that's the end of reality. And then they'll be aware of, you know, dwelling in this beautiful afterlife, which is supposedly the new reality, you know, or something like that. It's all nonsense. We cannot be separate from pure spaciousness. Nothing can. Or, as Longchenpa says, pure absence. Pure absence, absolutely pure absence, unadulterated, unchangeable, pure absence. How can you be absent from pure absence? Consider that. How can you be absent from pure absence? Can you absent yourself from that? No, your absence from it is still, you know, within the pure absence. You can't get free of it. Pure spaciousness, pure absence, the same way of talking about the same situation, the ground of being. You can't separate from it, but we can concoct this ridiculous farce, twisted farce, you know. It's twisted, and I've been able to see now this fundamental twist. And at first I looked at it and I saw it and I said, wow, that's really, that's a super twist there. And then you keep trying and keep trying looking at it, and then you say, it's not so I can see it, you know. It's all a dream, it's all a dream. See, nothing's ever fallen. No, nothing's falling. So as you look about you, we don't realize that we're completely used to looking at everything as if it's in a fallen state. It's falling. Somehow there's a fallenness possible in everything. And then the only change is to recognize that nothing has fallen. There's nothing in a fallen state. It's impossible. That's just a subtle little change. That's all that needs to happen, really. That's enlightenment, really. You have a new perception. That's a new perception. Ultimately, you drop perception altogether for knowing, which realizes that none of this was even possible in the first place. But intermediate step is to see that nothing is falling. There's nothing in a fallen state. Nothing is falling. Nothing can ever fall. See, how can you fall out of pure spaciousness? How can anything fall out of it? It can be moving within it, but how can you define that as falling, falling, falling out of it? How can that have any meaning or definition at all, that something is on its way to falling out of spaciousness? Is that possible? So all motion is equally the same as far as meaning goes. It's zero falling out of spaciousness, zero, none. But we're used to seeing all this motion and everything as having meaning, as if we're remembering how we fell out of spaciousness. So everything has that paradigm. We look at everything in that way, like, oh, I'm viewing the falling out of spaciousness. But when you realize you're not viewing that at all, then, you know, Satori, enlightenment. Everything just as it is. You know, so That's apex yoga, okay? Now, a lot of people in the West have been working on that because they realize this crisis is coming. So, you know, I respect all that work very much. I feel that it could be better. It could be better. I don't know. It's hard to evaluate it. Hopefully we can all get this. It is that subtle change, just a subtle little change of nothing is falling. Nothing is on its way to falling out of anything. And that provides a different perception, a different experience, a different bliss. It provides bliss, really. Just like that. It's that simple. But getting there, there's this twist, you know, this on it, like this dream is twisted, like the falling out of, you know, we're in the box. We haven't got out of that box of the mythology of existence. But it is possible to get out of it, just like I have. Just looking at it and able to see it now. It's just we don't try, we don't look there, we don't expect that to look there. We think, no, this must be right. We've fallen, we're from grace, we're trying to get back to grace. The devolution has happened now, the evolution needs to happen. We've gone out from the Godhead, now we're going back, and all this stuff. You say, oh, of course, you know, that's the spiritual teaching. None of that's true. It's all a mythology, it's all a dream. Nothing's ever gone out from God. How could anything go out from pure spaciousness? Where is it going? That's ridiculous. How could anything go back into pure spaciousness? Where is it going back in from? Where is it going back in from? Ask yourself that question. So not everybody likes this approach. It just happens to be that this is the approach that has come up for me. I just happen to find myself here after a lifetime of efforts. I didn't set out to have any particular approach. It's just this is how I'm seeing it now. And it's, you know, it's good. I like it. It's apex yoga, actually. Radical Dzogchen apex yoga or Christ clarity. It's all the same. Where you just get clear on this fundamental issue, just like that. That's it. How could anything be going anywhere? Really, falling anywhere? How can it be coming from anywhere or going anywhere in pure spaciousness? Really? Now, Jesus and Anandamayi, they all know this perfectly well as well, too. But just their style and their approach and the way that they're helping others differs a little bit from what I seem to be aligned with. So that's all fine. It's all good. Certainly, if you have one spiritual agent, doesn't mean that yours is better than others, or, you know, we're not judging or comparing that way. It's just what do you resonate with best? What's most practical? What's most helpful? What saves you the most time? You know, that's the key thing. And only that is important. So at some point, this dawns, this change in perception of perceiving everything in motion, this whole existence of, you know, it's some drama happening here of going and coming and falling and returning and all this stuff, to there's no drama at all. And there's never been any drama. So you go from all these emotions and upset and like, to just steady bliss. And remember, you don't have to forget the bliss. Because you're not trying to remember how you forgot the bliss, how you forgot reality. You're not trying to realize how you forgot reality and separated from it. Because you didn't forget reality and you didn't separate from it. You didn't go anywhere. Nothing ever went anywhere. So, there you go. All right, cold here, I'm telling you. Yeah, it's all breath is fogging up, and here we go, and Isun is like brightening up just incredibly. You know, like, wow, okay, here we go, folks. Everything's brightening up in a big hurry right now. Very great. That's it.